Brocard's problem and conjecture. These are two very different things, so we'll start with a non-prime number one. Now, in mathematics, a factorial is a bunch of sequential numbers multiplied together, starting with one. Seems like a childish thing, but it is useful at counting things like combinations of probabilities. For example, this is a form for a Powerball lottery ticket. The odds of you winning the potentially large jackpot are, this formula here from combinatorics, which involves factorials, that damn extra Powerball number is, of course, there to ensure that it's that much harder to win. So we can simplify this a little here, a little there, get rid of the division. So, the odds of winning the big jackpot are, $292,201,338 to 1. But, you know, when the jackpot gets bigger than that, I mean, hey, why not buy a ticket or two? So, two thoughts about Brocard's problem. First, as it says here on Wikipedia, Brocard's problem has three known solutions called Brown numbers, 4, 5, and 7. For whatever reason, they're not called Brocard numbers. I hate to think it was because he was disinterested in trying to solve some problem, but anyway, so there are only three known solutions to Brocard's problem. It's a phenomenon with these types of unsolved problems, which I just made up, that I will call the unwritten rule of small numbers. There's a similar situation with the Gourmand-Teague conjecture, which has two solutions with small numbers, and also with the Catalan conjecture, where 2 to the third power is equal to 3 to the second power minus 1. And it's actually been proven that that's the only solution possible to that problem. I mean, if you tried 2 to the 50th power, it's, well, that's just not the same. The second thought is, Paul Erdos said he didn't think there's another solution to Brocard's problem, and I'm inclined to agree. Also, it's had the hell tested up. It's been tested quite a bit. Apparently, as of 2020, as it says here on Wikipedia, it's been tested with an N of 1 quadrillion. I mean, 1 quadrillion factorial is a very big number. And there is actually a formula for determining how many digits are in a given factorial number, and I'll try Stirling's equation instead. Yep, pretty massive number. Too big for my abilities right now. So a fourth answer out that far probably doesn't exist. But if it did...
Thank you, George. Hey!
Thanks, guys. If it did exist, it would have to obey two rules. One, a squared number only has an even number of trailing zeros. Now, in factorials, once you get past 10 or so, you get a growing number of trailing zeros. And there's even a formula for that. We'll skip that for now. So in order to mesh with a squared integer, the number of trailing zeros in the factorial has to be even. Then you add the plus 1, and you have a number ending with 0, 1. The mod is a term in division that means the remainder of the division. So, if m squared ends with 01, there are four possibilities for m mod 100. 1, 49, 51, and 99. Because if you square a number ending in 01, 49, 51, or 99, the resulting square will end in 01. But again, it's like putting apples and oranges in the same crate. I mean, you could do it, but Costco wouldn't be happy. Okay, on to the next. Brocard's conjecture. It's actually quite similar to Goldbach's conjecture in that it makes a counting game out of the prime numbers. But where the proof of Goldbach's conjecture required indirect means, we can approach Brocard's conjecture directly. It works like this. You take two consecutive prime numbers, you square them, two consecutive prime numbers, you square them, then you count the number of prime numbers between the two. And the great part is, you don't have to worry about the endpoints, as they're not primes. Hey, a squared integer is never a prime. So, Brocard conjectured that, in between these two squares, there has to be at least four primes. And as with Goldbach's conjecture, when you're starting out, it seems like the conjecture's not going to make it. But we take our convenient spreadsheet here, and we move along a little bit, and we see a general trend forming. there's fluctuation because of the fluctuation of the primes, but in general, this gap, we'll call it a Brocard gap, or the gap between the two squares, as we roll along, this gap gets very, very big, and the number of primes gets very, very much larger than four. As Norm Macdonald might have said, it seems to be very, very true. Thankfully, we can once again rely on the prime number theorem of Hadamard and de la Vallée-Poussin. In this case, it would look like this. I should probably point out that pi sub x is notation for the number of primes up to a given number x. It's called the prime counting function, even though there is not yet an official function for counting primes, just various algorithms and computer programs or data tables that exist out there in the real world. Okay, back to our function. And sure enough, as n increases, the value of the formula increases. It doesn't work for 3 and 5, but once you get past 5, it's higher than 4 all the way. It's kind of like the old fable about putting grains of rice on a chessboard. You start with one and you keep doubling until, man, I got everything on the internet. But in the name of science, let's give this thing a real test. As it says in several places on the web, Bertil Neiman's maximal gap of 1,132, discovered on January 24th, 1999. I don't know what day that was. Because once you start getting interested in prime numbers, it really seems to be more about the gaps between the prime numbers than the prime numbers themselves. And this gap of 1,132 is apparently unusual because it occurs in a spot that no one expected it to. So, let's try to find some prime numbers that will take advantage of this gap with Brocard's conjecture. I picked 41,148,293 and 41,148,307, a gap of 14 between them. We square them and we get these two big numbers. Each has 16 digits. Make a note of that, as it'll come up later. So between the two big numbers is a gap of 1.15 billion. Still kind of big, but somewhere in there we can subtract 1,132. Keep that in mind. So let's count the number of primes. Oh, but first, let's use the Hadamard formula. Hadamard formula says 31,920,228. Actual number of primes, 32,860,062. So that's pretty close. The Hadamard formula is under by about 3%. And of course, larger than 4. The actual number of primes has 8 digits, and the squared numbers have 16, or twice as many digits. Do one more? Okay. My fellow Java programmers might recognize this one. Well, the functionality of the big integer class is a little lacking, needless to say. This time I picked a twin prime. A twin prime just means two prime numbers with a gap of 2 between them. We square them, and we get these two large 19-digit numbers. The result with Hadamard, 271,390,272. Actual total primes, 277,756,964. So it's pretty close. The Hadamard formula is under by about 3%. And of course, even more larger than 4. The actual number of primes this time had 9 digits, and the squared numbers had 19, or just over twice as many digits. Now, this is, of course, not the stuff of mathematical proofs, but from these two points, the trend seems pretty clear. And it seems like no matter what single large maximal prime gap is used, the size of the Brocard gap is so overwhelming as to make it true. So if we were to use this 87-digit number here on Wikipedia, the total number of primes might be a 43-digit number. And if we were to use this 216,000-digit number, which is a probable prime, the total number of primes might be a 108,000-digit number. And even if the quantum zero-Kelvin computer ever gets up and running, because, let's face it, 14 quadrillion calculations a second is nice, but still too slow for the largest prime numbers. That's why there's all this talk of probable primes or pseudo-primes or the RSA algorithm for public key cryptography, because large prime numbers are so labor-intensive. There are even prizes for finding a 1-million-digit prime number. Now they're up to prizes for 100 million digits. But even though the prime numbers become less common as one approaches infinity, there's still quite a lot of them, and the squares of even twin primes get so ridiculously large that it's safe to say that the number of primes you'll have to count will continue to grow. In fact, you'd probably be hard-pressed to find a point out there in the far reaches of infinity where the number of primes between two squares ever begins to drop. We'll make that the next challenge. Oh, and thank you for indulging me. Thank you very much for watching. Coming soon, the Collatz conjecture. Now, the Collatz conjecture has been tested up to 2 to the 68th power, which is about a, that'd be about a 20, 21, 22 digit number. So why don't we go ahead and try a 1 million digit number, see what happens.